One person who sensed an angel presence in her life and responded to it is Bridget Fonger, who opened an angel store in Pasadena.
I believe that throughout my life I've had angel experiences. Now looking back, and I think that all of us have, it's just a matter of being aware of what that is. Some people call it synchronicity, some people call it a religious experience, some people call it, you know, this weird thing happened to me, or some people call it ghosts or spirits or talking with the other side. And
do you think people really believe in angels?
Children believe in angels, and most of the time people never really lose that belief. It gets covered up or they forget. But now angels are coming back into mainstream and socially acceptable thinking.
We interviewed Karen Goldman, who has written books on angels.
When angels came to me as a topic, it started just by exploring what an angel is from within. I started getting answers about how everything connects. And, you know, angels as a symbol, everything we know about angels is that they can appear on earth. They're also from heaven. They're with people when they die. They transcend all the worlds. They're messengers between the light and the dark. And this woman named Joanne.
Karen told us a story about a woman named Joanne, who was a foster parent for young children and babies.
Babies all the time. She said that from a sound sleep, a bright light woke her up, and she heard a voice say, "Joanne, get up and sit at the foot of the bed." So it woke her up. She immediately picked up the baby, got up, and sat at the foot of the bed. And as soon as she got to the foot of the bed and sat down, there was a tremendous earthquake, and glass from a great big window that was beside the bed shattered and fell all over the bed and would have cut herself and the baby.
We visited Bridget Fonger's angel store to see what sort of angels we could find there.
You really do have every kind of angel here.
I try.
Why did you open the store?
I had a series of sort of angelic experiences, and the first of which was my little friend died last year when he was 2.5. His name was Gavin Murray, and he was like a living angel. And when he was alive, I made a lot of angel paintings for him. He died of cancer. He was a big inspiration for the story, and I have felt his presence a lot.
I've never seen a pair of angel wings this big. Where'd you get these?
Those wings are the result of one of the hundreds of synchronistic events that went to the opening of this store. I was shopping one day and I saw this man across the room, and he had these rare Indian beads on. And at one point he looked over, and I took that as an invitation to ask him about these beads, because they're very rare, special beads. And I said, "Did you get those in India?" And he said, "Yeah. Have you been to India?" And I said, "Yeah, several times." And he said, "Were you there in 1989? And I said, "Yes." And he said, "I remember you." And we had been at the same ashram in 1989, and he remembered me. I didn't remember him. But anyway, we started talking. At the end of our conversation, I handed him my card at the angel store, and he said, "The angel store, I was just on the phone about my angel wings." And I said, "You're what?" And he said, because I'd been looking for angel wings for the store, and he said, "Yeah, let's put them in your store." I made these wings for Sharon Stone for the cover of Premier Magazine. They're really beautiful. I'm sure you'll love them, and everybody loves them.
Bridget told us about a time when her back had locked, and she arranged for a professional massage to ease the pain.
Locked. She came to my house, and she did shiatsu, and it was an amazing experience. And as the massage was going on, my back was unlocking, and
I was working on Bridget, and as I was on the side of her body, I began to kind of see in my mind's eye this feminine presence.
It was an amazing massage, and I felt that I was healing as it was going on, but I was thinking, "God, is this all of this pain going to go away?" Because it seemed like a lot that she was going to have to do.
I just let it be there for a while, and I wasn't going to say anything about it. I was just going to move along and continue my healing work on her body. But it stayed with me for quite a while.
She was holding me in a way, and I felt that something else was holding me, something bigger than me. And I saw this golden color.
This glowing kind of hair, gold, and it looked like hair, but maybe it wasn't hair. It just had that image because it was very long and it flowed outward.
But the most extraordinary part of the massage was at the end. Laura was sort of finishing up and had her hands on my head and neck area, and she pulled her hands away, and I felt her pull her hands away. And then I felt another pair of hands come into the same place where her hands had just been, and they weren't her hands. But I didn't want to say, those aren't your hands, are they? Because I felt like either it would ruin if it was something like different, or she would say, oh yeah, they are my hands, are you crazy?
I let it be there for a while because I wasn't going to say anything to Bridget and disturb her, and I didn't really know how open she'd be to anything like that going on. I wasn't even sure how open I was at that moment.
And I saw that same golden light that I had seen, and then I saw this like deep, bright pink and deep, bright blue, and it was like there was like an enormous woman standing above me.
And then it started to retract, it started to pull back up and through me and then recede a little bit. And at that point, I thought, I'm going to have to tell Bridget what's going on here. So I said, Bridget, I said, I don't know if I should tell you this or what you think about this, but I felt this real feminine energy presence while I was working on you.
And before I said anything, I made her describe what she had felt and seen, and it was exactly what I had experienced.
Colors like blues and pinks that were just rushing down, as if to say it was some dress or something, but it was just a rush of intense colors. And we sat there and compared stories, and she says, well, what kind of blue? Was it really intense blue? Was it really in it? And I said, yes, that was it. It was intense blue. And it wasn't like a pastel pink. It was a really intense pink.
And we just kind of went back and forth on the details of what we had experienced, and it was neither of us was making up any of it, and we were just sort of understanding that this thing that I thought had happened and that she thought had happened had truly happened.
It changes the way you see everything. You see the magic in all things, and life isn't ordinary, and that no matter how solid or how real the world can get on the freeways or any of these things, you begin to see that there's truly magic behind every door, behind everything.